In my opinion, calcium is one of the most underrated minerals, and using enough calcium can really drive great vegetative growth. The reason I like living soils is that if you do an okay job of mixing an initial starting soil, the plant and the soil and the microbes are doing the rest of the work. And I don't have to try to play God and say,
Also, is there a ratio of like a 3-to-1 or a ratio between phosphorus and potassium that you have identified a certain less or more or equal to really emphasize that last few
yeah.
weeks?
So if you have excessive phosphorus or excessive potassium or deficiency in either of them, you're not going to hit those ideal Brix levels.
Have you ever wondered the difference between calcium carbonate versus potassium carbonate? Well, in this video, we're going to get into it with Avsai. You're here with Mark Bowell on perfectgardens.com. Make sure to please check us out on Instagram, Facebook, and hit the notifications for future videos like this. And if you haven't checked out our $2.99 monthly membership, I highly recommend to do so. We have over 110 members constantly sharing quality content. Let's go ahead and get into the video.
Make sure to hit the join button on the bottom of every video.
I want to, I'm jumping back to your point. I thought about pH up and down, and I think that's brilliant in terms of using calcium carbonate as a source to pH up in veg, and then maybe a potassium base more in flour.
And can I explain my this again? I'm not a scientist, but as I think about it, can I explain my thought process? Okay, so because you're going from veg to flower and the plant stops growing, that's when I kind of encourage growers to back off on the calcium. Is it's like you said, it's holding on to the minerals and releasing that whole surface area kind of an exchange experience. But then also, I'm always finding a lot of growers dealing with a phosphorus deficiency. As you go later into flowering, and a lot of people talk about how phosphorus and potassium are affected by the amount of calcium. So then I was thinking, okay, if people need to use a pH up or to balance the soil, switch over to a potassium carbonate because that again, the and this is where I'm wondering is reacting with the hydrogen I'm thinking and it's releasing the CO2 and the potassium is being left behind, which then. It, again, increases the pH, but less calcium, less it's antagonizing. It's less antagonization on the potassium and the phosphorus which should minimize and encourage the ATP production because as they go into a harder condition, like hotter temperatures or colder environments, as it's finishing off, we need more ATP production to simple help it versus hinder it.
Listening to you makes me feel sorry for people who have to listen to me, because I think we think very, very similarly and we talk similarly. So a big map would definitely help. I was going on a slight. Calcium carbonate is very oxidizing, right? It's one of it's very oxidizing. You're releasing so much more oxygen with calcium carbonate. The way where I thought you were going is calcium to me is a great vegetative food, and we often have far too little calcium. We don't put enough emphasis on calcium. In my opinion, calcium is one of the most underrated minerals, and using enough calcium can really drive great vegetative growth. And at the same time, calcium is so valuable for root growth that it really maintains a good healthy root system. And so I was thinking you were promoting calcium carbonate in veg because calcium is so important in veg. And then I was thinking you were recommending potassium bicarbonate because potassium is so important in flour. And that's how
And I
that's
am.
how I was keeping it.
That's how I was recommending too, that for that reason. Exactly. But keep going. Keep going how you interpret it, because I want to just dive into whatever you're interpreting it the way you are.
Well, it's you know, the most important thing when we talk about minerals in general is the balance, right? And it's so hard to and that's to be honest, and I'm always transparent about this. The reason I like living soils is that, and especially just add water super soils, is that if you do an okay job of mixing an initial starting soil, the plant and the soil and the microbes are doing the rest of the work. And I don't have to try to play God and say, oh shit, I think I need a little bit of more magnesium, or I need a little bit more phosphorus, or I need this. The plant will dictate, say, listen, I need more phosphorus. I'm going to really push my mycorrhizae to deliver me some more phosphorus. You know, because that's where that ATP is, right? That's that. If I need energy, I need ATP. So that's what the plant needs for energy. And the plant recognizes that the glucose that it's making, that is going to be good energy for those that don't know how to produce energy from the sun, right? So fungi can't, you know, they can't photosynthesize. They need that sugar, they need that carbohydrate as their energy source. They care less about phosphorus. They can ship off that phosphorus for the plant that needs that phosphorus for its energy in ATP. You know, in my opinion, that's that whole exchange of sugar versus it's one form of energy being shifted for another form of energy for that whole plant.
Okay, did we kind of encourage synthetic growers right there? Because that sucks if we didn't.
Do we
help out the organic growers by creating a more healthy environment for microbes to exist and flourish in different as the seasons are changing? Because there it does get hotter week four on before it drops off in temperature normally. So mm-hmm. there is more stressful conditions, what we're discussing. And so it would make sense, right? Because the plant is stopped growing, so we don't need as much calcium. And we do really need to buff up the ATP production. And that's why I'm always thinking also, is there a ratio of like a 3-to-1 or a ratio between phosphorus and potassium that you have identified a certain less or more or equal to make that really emphasize that last few weeks?
And there's always, there are these ratios, and definitely a P to K ratio is pretty critical, especially when it comes to sugar production. If you're imbalanced in terms of your P to K ratio, you will not hit those Brix levels that you want. So if you have excessive phosphorus or excessive potassium or deficiency in either of them, you're not going to hit those ideal Brix levels. And it's so critical to remember that in the cannabis space, based on some type of misinterpretation of some research data, we use way more phosphorus than we need to. So it's the only reason you have a phosphorus deficiency late in flower is perhaps because you have used too much calcium or you've got too much magnesium, because those are impacting the uptake of phosphorus, or your pH has risen too high or something like that. Those are the reasons you may run into a phosphorus deficiency in late flower, because to be honest, phosphorus is really important at a bit of root development and then whenever that plant needs that extra bit of energy, and typically needs extra energy right around transition. It's going from veg to flower. That's a really stressful time. It's got different growth. It's going to have that elongation as you flip into flower. It needs extra energy then. And it continues to need energy during that flowering period, but we add way too much phosphorus. And that's why, you know, many hydroponic growers are forced to do that flush, because their root zone is so caked with extra phosphorus that if they don't, the plant will continue to take up that phosphorus and you'll get that, you know,
lower oil production.
So in my thought process, you really do want I don't think we're in any way encouraging hydroponic growing. In many ways, we're encouraging having balanced nutrient soils and then letting the plant do a lot more of that work of deciding what we want to eat, when we want to eat it, and what form we want to eat. It's so important to recognize that the soil is so incredibly dynamic that within seconds, you can have species that are turning off and species that are turning on. And once again, thanks to all the work that Elaine Ingham did to highlight this, we now know that there's thousands and thousands of different species